Thank you, Dr. Miller. So I'm Wiharti Purba, like Dr. Miller explains. So I'm going to talk about broadleaf dog or Rumex obtusifolius. We're talking about how to identify this weed and also the management in blueberry and raspberry. And since Tim is my advisor, if you have questions, you can ask him. So first I will start to, I think it's kind of cut. I will start to introduce you to this plant and then how to identify it and compare it with another species. And then talking about how to manage it according to our research studies, and then closing. First, I will talking about the biology of broadleaf dog. So broadleaf dog, if you're familiar with buckwheat and rhubarb, they are coming from the same family, from smartwheat family, Polygonaceae, and they usually growing, they are perennial, they are growing as a rosette with the relatively large leaves, and it can grow up to 5 feet. And the flowers is usually coming as a cluster. It's green when it's young, and when it's mature, it's become browning. And several research shown reported that this plant produced a large number of seeds. Many paper describe that this annually it can produce 60,000 of seeds, but in another place like in Canada, it can produce, okay, that's better. In Canada, it can produce only 27,000, and in Japan, it's produced 50,000, but I believe it's quite a large number if you compare it with dandelion, which produce 50,000 of seeds. And these seeds are shed continuously from late summer, and it can germinate in any month if the year, if condition is favorable. And this plant also has ability to produce secondary taproot. And this fleshy taproot is actually one of the major concern from this plant. It can extend up to 5 feet inside of the soil, and it makes it difficult to control. Let's go internationally a little bit. I'm talking about how is this research of this species around the world. I believe in United States, this plant has been considered one of troublesome weed, and I look around to see if actually we have it in, maybe in my country, in Indonesia. And this is a map from invasive species compendium. And as you can see there, the red dot indicate that they are presented there, but it's not specifically reported. And the blue dot indicating they are widespread and already reported. And ecologically, broadleaf dog is found in widely different plant communities and habitat, and currently start to increase in agricultural area since it can compete with crops and can occupy the area that could be utilized by more crop species. You can see there in Europe, it's actually a native plant, but it show a characteristic of invasive alien species. So usually in this area, it's become a problem in grassland or in pastures, and they're kind of considering they have a lot of research in this area to see what is the economic impact of these plants to foraging to forage grass yield and quality. And also in central part of Europe, it's become a challenge for the organic farmers, or farmers that want to switch from conventional to organic. And we can also find it in Japan. And it's interesting that research in this area kind of concern of the metabolic secondary metabolite that this plant can produce. It has a high content of oxalate acid, so it is poisonous to foraging. If you have like a farm with also forage, it's poisonous. And here in United States and also in Mexico, there is a report that is perennial weed in alfalfa, and also we can find in ditches, roadside, and waste area. Related to the distribution of those species, actually broadleaf dog is reported found it throughout United States, including every western, including several western states, except for Nevada and Wyoming and North Dakota. But we have to know that the beauty of this mat is they collected the data of the species. So they the plant may can be there, but there is no report. So especially wheat record usually tend, they spend time more to collect crop species or beneficial plant other than wheat. And this is some species that I mentioned. If people mention about dog, actually dog is a common name that can be referred to several different species in Rumex genus. And according to USDA plant database, and as we are trying to find the dog species in Washington State, we can find about 12 species, like in a picture. It is about 70 record they have. It is studied from a broadleaf dog on the top left of you, and then curly dog, and there is a winch dog, a western dog, American golden dog, willow dog, and red sorrel. Most of them are native plant, but broadleaf, or we sometimes people call it bitter dog, and curly dog are both invasive plant. And if people are talking about troublesome weed, if you are referred about dog, usually in agricultural area, it's referred to broadleaf dog and curly dog. So between broadleaf dog and curly dog, it's quite difficult for us to compare this type of weed. Sometimes people ask me, is it the same with curly dog? So they're actually different. Broadleaf dog, Latin name is Rumex obtusifolius, and curly dog is Rumex crispus. Two obvious diagnostic features that can distinguish those two species is the leaf shape and also the width of the leaf. Broadleaf, of course, have more broader leaf compared to dog, curly dog, and curly have that wavy margin. And then if we see the distribution around Washington State, we can see curly dog is more distributing in all around the area compared to broadleaf dog. And it's easier for us to find broadleaf dog in western Washington. So this is one of the pictures of this species in berry production. The left picture I show you is one picture that I got from Dr. Jerry Whalen. It is a broadleaf dog infestation in raspberry. And on the right side, this is pictures of broadleaf dog in an open area. Actually, if we look closer in area around Washington State, it's easier for us to find this plant in more open area, because actually this plant is more easier to establish in open area, and then once it's become established, it's become troublesome. So considering the biology of this plant, I would like to highlight several problems from this plant. This is like high competitive species. Like I mentioned before, they really have a high impact in the pasture land. They have high impact because they consume a lot of nitrogen compared to crops. And then some research already informed, I cannot say that it's a potential host for blueberry and raspberry, but there are some research in Kiwi, like in New Zealand area, that there is a wheat field that the survival of certain wheat field that increasing following the abundance of this broadleaf dog. And in the fact that it's hard to control, we do have several herbicides that commonly used in berry production and also for polygenesis family, but the efficacy of herbicide for broadleaf dog in berry production has not been reported. So two main biology that we were concerned here, that it has a high fecundity and longevity of seeds. It can grow, it can remain viable inside of the soil for more than 40 years. And because it has vegetative fragments, sometimes even though we have cultivate or cutting, they're still able to grow, become one individual. So we want to highlight that one of the strategy that we offer here, that we have to account the seed germination. So one of the management that we want to offer, if a grower asks me what should we do to manage this plant the first time, because it has a vegetative fragment, it has a fleshy taproot, we suggest you to have early shoot removal to delay flowering, and concern that they also produce a large number of seeds. And hand pulling is not normally practicable, and usually that not result complete removal, but if it is a load, pulling to remove the entire root is better, or at least 4 inches of root collar, because in that 4 inch there is an collar of the roots that have the regenerative capacity. And for chemical management, this is one of the research that we conducted for the past 2 years. We have several herbicides that already registered in blueberry. This is the list of herbicides that registered in blueberry. And most of them, we pick some of them that has control, show control, or put in a label for blueberry. And we use the highest rate that is suggested inside of the management handbook. And we're using 18 herbicide that represented 9 mode of action. So from this list of herbicide, we want to see the efficacy of herbicide that we choose to control the established broadleaf dog, even though we found out that this herbicide reported to show a good control to some of polygenous family smartweed or knotweed. But we want to apply, to see how it's the efficacy specifically to broadleaf dog. And we want to determine the optical timing because we applied in 2 different seasons. And the same of that, considering the high number of seeds that produced by this plant, we want to see if the application that we did on spring show reduce the germination percentage of seeds. This is the list of the herbicide. The rate and also the timing. We use 16 herbicide on spring and add another 2 additional herbicide to be applied during fall, and we conduct in 2016 and 2017, and it is randomized completely block design with 4 applicates with plot size 2.4 by 9.1 meters, and we're using a backpack sprayer. So we are actually applying this herbicide not in a blueberry field, but there is a fallow field that full of broadleaf dog close to our extension office. This is the spring treatment. What we got from here is from 2 weeks after treatment and 4 weeks after treatment, we found out that turbicil and also turbicil active ingredient and glyphosate showed the highest impact. As you can see later in this 8 week after treatment, we collected the biomass of the seeds. The biomass of the plant left on the field. So as you see in the graph, here we are looking for a shorter bar, and it indicates less biomass of less broadleaf dog left in the field. So 2 of them that we found is glyphosate touchdown and also Sinbar or turbicil. Other than that, we also see a good result from Carmex. And then the next year in 2017, we still see the result of Sinbar and touchdown or turbicil and glyphosate. So those 2 herbicides is the one that we recommend. Other than that, we still see some changes and some differences result from 1 year to another year. And from the fall treatment, as I mentioned before, we tried 18 herbicide in a fall treatment. And we found out that glyphosate, which show a good impact on spring, only show a little impact here, especially after 6 months after treatment. And then we found a diclobenyl or caserin and pronamide or curb showing a good impact 6 months after treatment. This is the picture of some of the trial. From the A1 is glyphosate, and the B is non-treated one. It's now growing with horsetail. And the C, pronamide or curb, and diclobenyl and caserin and C and D. And on the second objective, we want to see when is the right time for the seeds actually germinated. So we conducted 1 germination testing to compare 3 different temperature, 59, 68, and 77. We do it using a moistened paper substrate, like you see in the picture is the blue substrate. And because this seed needs light, so we use it in a petri dish. And then this is the result of the germination. We can see actually these seeds show germination after several days on 20 degrees or 68 degrees Fahrenheit. And we can see actually it's a summertime in Washington state. And so the application of a chemical or herbicide is recommended to do before summertime. And the second time I mentioned here, we have another testing because we already found out that it's germinated on 68 degrees Fahrenheit. So we want to test if the herbicide that we apply during spring, and we collected the seed to see if the herbicide can evac the germination of the seeds. And the result is quite, this is the germination percentage, and the x-axis is the herbicide active ingredient. As you can see here, it's only one, only clopyrrolate that show the impact of the seeds, and it shows the decrease of germination under 30%. So talking about how to, based on this result, how do we apply the chemical that we suggest in blueberry and raspberry production? So we can actually start it from fall treatment. As I mentioned before, the result of the fall treatment, we can apply pronamide or kerb and dicarbonate or casuarine starting from fall. And then that we believe that it will provide adequate result in spring. And then spring, we can continue with applying turbosil or probably also add it with spot treatment of surviving broadleaf dog with glyphosate. We are concerning of injury issues, so we suggest to do spot treatment that we'll discuss later. And or also we can apply glyphosate and clopyrrolate or stinger, but it is just for blueberry because stinger is not registered in raspberry. And in order to consider the germination of the seed, we suggest if there is a pre-emergence product you want to apply, it's better to apply it later summer. So one by one, starting from glyphosate, if it is you want to apply it in blueberry, it's better to apply it at least 10 days before planting. And actually glyphosate, because glyphosate is non-selective herbicide, so the application of glyphosate demand the awareness of crop injury. So any amount of glyphosate drifted to blueberry leaves and bark may potentially slow the growth. So we suggest to do spot treatment. And if you're doing actually in raspberry, it's a high risk for raspberry, especially because there is a growth of primocane that might be surrounding the broadleaf dog. But if you are doing that, we suggest only during site preparation. And for turbosil, turbosil usually show different response from different variety of blueberry. So we suggest to try to evaluate the injury potential first, at least for one row. And do not apply on a gravelly soils or soil with less than 1% organic matter, because turbosil can absorb with organic matter. It's the one that actually avoid the crop injury. And then for raspberry, turbosil that we are using here is actually half of the one that registered for raspberry. So turbosil in raspberry is limited from 0.8 to 1.6 pound active ingredient per acre, while in blueberry it's higher. And the one that we are using here is 2.4. So the rate that we are using here is not recommended for using in raspberry. In pronamide and blueberry and raspberry, it's also suggested to be made in non-frozen soil to help them incorporate into the herbicide. And the maximum rate for raspberry is 3 pounds active ingredient per acre, which is higher than the one that actually we are using here. And for dicarbonyl, there is a restriction of the rate. The one that we are using here is 6 pound active ingredient per acre, but the one is raspberry should not exceed 4. So this is the last of my presentation, just to give another conclusion that we can start from fall for dormant season application of pronamide or kerb and dicarbonate or casuarine, and study with spring application with turbosil or spot treatment. With blueberry, we can incorporate it with clover leaf in order to avoid to decrease the seed germination of the next season. That's all. Thank you. If you have any questions.